Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Harbor by Katrine Engberg. Translated by Tara Chase. Read by Graeme Malcolm.
To Cassius, my anchor, my hourglass, my little sun that shines. Monday, April 15th. Prologue. After spending his weekend in bed, Michael woke up Monday morning with a throat full of glass shards. He had just pulled the comforter up around his fever-laden head and decided to call in sick, when his wife came in to stand at the foot of the bed, crossing her arms and giving him that look. Michael got up. After all, she was right. His job as crane operator at the incineration plant was still new, and he couldn't risk making a bad first impression. Pumped up on a mixture of Tylenol and black coffee, he drove out to Copenhagen's industrial island, Refshaleøen. The car radio alternating between soft hits and crisp commercials, and gradually he started to feel better. He parked the car, nodded to the guards in the lobby, and rode the elevator up to the staff room to change his clothes. Strictly speaking, that wasn't necessary because the negative pressure in the sealed waste silo left the surrounding facility nearly odor-free, but Michael always changed into his boiler suit anyway. He laced up his protective work boots, put on his helmet, and walked through the plant with knees aching from the flu. The walkways around the silo made up their own world of steel and valves, control panels, boilers, and signs. There were no windows, the incineration plant comprising a closed system that lacked weather or any circadian rhythm. Michael casually ducked under the hot water pipes, said hello to a couple of co-workers by the steam turbines, and let himself into the crane operator's room. He stuck his lunch in the refrigerator and made a pot of coffee before sinking into his work chair with a heartfelt sigh. A ferocious scene came into view in front of him, one that he still had not fully gotten used to. A window, the only one in the entire waste silo, offered a view into the heart of the incineration plant. The underbelly of Western civilization, a massive aggregated heap of filthy futility. Michael hadn't worked with garbage before, and on his first few shifts he had felt sick to his stomach, as if he were witnessing the apocalypse and ought to be doing something instead of just watching it. It had gotten better over time. He had even started eating the cookies his co-workers left behind while moving the claw. The claw. At 8 meters across from leg to leg, it resembled something from a dystopian world where giant spiders ruled a dead planet. Michael had brought many pictures of the claw home to his 6-year-old son, who firmly believed his dad had the coolest job in the world. In reality, his dad's job was a little boring. The system that controlled the claw, moving it from the chutes where the waste carts were emptied and over to the ovens, was automated. Michael was only there to observe the transfer of the waste from left to right, ad infinitum, and make sure that nothing went wrong.
"Good morning," said Kasper Skute as he walked in and sat in the chair next to Michael.
Occasionally, the process engineers came to check if there was trouble in the control system. Michael hadn't noticed anything.
"Any problems so far?"
"Nope." Luckily, the engineers rarely spoke to the crane operators, or anyone really who didn't understand their techno-babble. So Michael knew he would be able to work in peace, which was just as well. He felt feverish and hot, and perhaps should have defied his wife and stayed in bed after all.
"Coffee?" Kasper asked.
"Thanks, I'm good."
The engineer got up and clanked around with cups and spoons behind him, then yawned loudly and sank back into the chair beside Michael, so they were once more seated side by side, watching the silo.
Michael pulled his bag closer and dug around in it for something to relieve his sore throat, hoping he still had a couple of lozenges left. He found a pack of Ricola drops and gratefully popped one into his mouth. The claw approached the window with a full load. It was always an impressive sight when it swung by really close. Trash dangled from its enormous grabbing arms like tentacles on a jellyfish. A rope, a dirty tarp, a sneaker. Michael leaned closer to the glass, squinting. That shoe was attached to something. Just as the load passed right in front of the window, an arm emerged, flopping out of the trash and dangling limply from the claw. Next to him, Casper spat his coffee at the window. Then Michael slammed the dead man button. Saturday, April 13th. 2 days earlier. Chapter 1. The ocean closed over his head, and he sank to the bottom, away from the light at the surface. A kelp plant caressed his arms, inviting him deeper. He was tempted to just let go, exhale one last time and fall, let his body dissolve into motes dancing in the sea's vertical rays of sunlight, and surrender to the mermaids of the bottomless blue. But the grey waters of Snickerstein Marina were far from the bottomless blue. Jeppe Koerner pushed off from the bottom and stretched his arms up toward the light. Seconds later, he broke the surface and inhaled.
"I was starting to think you would never come back up."
Jeppe shook the water out of his ears and squinted up at the figure on the dock. Above the surface, the world was warm and bright. He swam to the ladder and searched with his feet for the slippery bottom rung. Then he looked down one last time. The cool depths of the sea always stirred a longing in him, some kind of death wish, perhaps.
"I don't understand how you can stay in so long. 10 seconds and I'm freezing."
Johannes Lemark shivered in his bathrobe and held a towel out to Jeppe.
"Let's hit the sauna and warm up before the senior crowd arrives. I can't stand the sight of all those varicose veins."
He winked, as if to take the sting out of his harsh remark, and headed for the sauna. Jeppe dried himself and stuck his feet into the slightly too small sandals Johannes had found for him to use. Johannes, renowned actor and one of Jeppe's oldest friends, was renting the ground floor of an old brick house by the harbour in Snickerstein for the summer while he looked for a new place to live. His repeated attempts to save the marriage with his husband of 12 years had failed, and the inner-city condo they owned together was now for sale. Meanwhile, Johannes was licking his wounds far from the prying eyes of the public in the old fishing village of Snickerstein, north of Copenhagen. The rundown house was leaky and the yard overgrown, but Johannes seemed to thrive in the makeshift chaos overlooking the waters of the Øresund. He'd even begun attacking the yard with a hedge trimmer and loppers, stubbornly insisting that mowing the lawn and weeding the patio felt meditative.
"Huh, I think we lucked out. The sauna's empty."
Johannes held the door of the little black-painted building on the breakwater open for Jeppe. They made themselves comfortable on the sauna's wooden benches and let the oven's dry heat rise up through the wood and bring the life back into their cold bodies. The early spring weather had been unusually sunny and warm for Denmark, but there was still a bite to the air, and the water temperature hadn't crept up above the mid-40s.
"Would you look at us, all grown up, winter bathers in the sauna," Johannes said with a chuckle. "We're just a pastrami sandwich and a senior pass to the Louisiana Museum away from turning into our parents."
"What's wrong with pastrami?" Jeppe asked, squeezing the salt water out of his short hair with his hands to stop the chilly trickle down his back.
"I'm afraid we turned into our parents a long time ago. You just haven't noticed yet because the guys you pick up are half your age." "Oh, would you stop?"
Johannes snapped a rolled-up towel at Jeppe's arm, and Jeppe responded by punching him on the shoulder. They rubbed their bruises, laughing.
"Besides, my young boyfriends keep me fit. Look, I've never been hotter than now."
Johannes smiled enigmatically.
youthful, and only ever lonely on Sundays. How about you? You practically have a wife and kids now. How's that going?
Yeppe looked down at his feet, which pearled with beads of seawater and sweat.
Indeed, he had got in Sarah what he might call a package deal, one that he had never pictured himself signing up for, and he often found himself walking the very fine line between love and irritation.
"We haven't moved in together yet," Yeppe said. "It's not so easy when there are kids involved."
"On the other hand, it's a way to have kids." Johannes tipped his head to the side and dried his ears.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.